Who turned off the nice music? Hope I didn't break anything. Music, where are you?
Shut it! And get me out of here! I'm thirsty!
Rayman, I need medical attention.
So, here we are in ClearLeaf Forest. Last time on Rayman 3, Andre attempted to take over the world, but didn't, because he got eaten by Glowbox. So, we're here to find a doctor, so that isn't the case anymore. But right off the bat, we have an encounter with some of his hoodlums. Andre's hoodlums, not the doctor's. As far as I know, he doesn't have any. So, I really like ClearLeaf Forest as a first area, just because, you know, it's not exactly your standard, like, generic grassy land beginning area sort of thing. It also shows that Andre wasn't completely unprepared going into the Fairy Council, despite the fact that he only had a few soldiers with him, considering he was planning on leaving with a few thousand. Elsewhere, he did have hoodlums start to set up camp. For example, they seem to have occupied this building here, and captured a Teensy, so let's free him.
Thanks, Big Nose!
I'm not even going to point out the irony here.
I need to go fire up the barbecue.
So, that's a Teensy of this particular area. These guys are called the Silkins? Anyway, if you see some wearing red, I think they're supposed to be shepherds. Yeah, those are Silkins. There are various Teensy variations other than just the Grand Minimus that we saw back in the first area. So, anyway, what was I saying again? Oh yeah, I suppose I should mention, of course, Andre was going after the Heart of the World because it is composed of Lums. I won't get too into the plot of Rayman 2, but basically, the Heart of the World in that game was split into the Thousand Lums that were the collectibles alongside the cages that were also in that game. But he didn't succeed here, so we're not collecting yellow Lums. Another one of those doors. And one of you jerks. Oh, two of you jerks. And one of them has a dollar sign over their heads, and if you haven't noticed by this point, that means he has something he'll drop when he dies. Usually it's one of those detergents, so let's go after him. But first, another cage. Oh, by the way, if you're wondering what that disc is, once all those slots fill up, you will actually get a little more health, so it does pay to find Teensies. In addition, some can be missed for a little while, however, you can revisit levels if you pause and then go and find that particular chapter in the options menu. However, do be warned, of course, that if you do that, you will lose progress in the current area. Anyway, we've got a new ability here from the Red Can. This is the Heavy Metal Fist. It's more or less the poster transformation of this game, I guess. It's the one you see most often. Glowbox is clearly not impressed. So, if it wasn't obvious from its design, the Heavy Metal Fist is all about being powerful. It can break open piggy banks in one hit, and these doors, which are normally unbreakable, can be destroyed with a charge punch. However, be warned that it is one of the fastest depleting forms. I believe third fastest? Vortex is around for a little while longer than this one. Anyway, not only was that building back there occupied, but as we can see here, the Hoodlums have begun constructing things elsewhere. It's not just a takeover. Well, I guess this is sort of a takeover. But they are doing their own thing as well. And I really like this as a design. It is really nice and subtle. You probably won't really, you know, just sit down and think, those dastardly hoodlums are taking over by building their own bases here. How sinister. You're probably not going to say any combination of those words. That being said, though, yeah, I just think it's a really cool design thing. Now, in addition, not only have they been building bases, but there is a certain drink that Andre is also fond of that they seem to be collecting here and there. And if we've collected all the treasures in the area, which I believe we have, yep. If we go up here, we'll see a barrel. Uh-oh. That's got a plum on it. Well, Back in the Fairy Council, Murphy said something about a little bit of an allergy that Glowbox has. And, okay, I don't think any of my allergies have ever caused me to be able to swim up a waterfall, or be able to swim in the first place. But yeah, we have a little, I don't want to call it a mini-game, because it's not that, but it's just a little action segments. Just rapidly tap either one of those buttons and avoid the piranhas. And eventually we'll reach the top. It's a very short segment, provided you don't get hit, and it is fairly easy. Those are some slow piranhas. Not good jumpers, apparently. Now, if I remember correctly, this is a fairly large area right here. It's very battle-heavy. Despite the fact that fights in this game don't really take too long, which is nice. I'm glad they don't draw them out too much, because it's a fairly simple combat system, and they usually make sure not to draw things out. Enemies go down in only a few hits. Really, I think their main advantage, at least at this point, is their sheer numbers. Also, the fact that it's pretty easy to sneak up on them. I don't know how none of them notice this, but they don't. Meaning, we'll get to sneak up on that guy over there. So, while we are here, I suppose I'll talk about scoring a little bit more. So, in the last part, I mentioned how, well, you probably also saw as well, that anything you pick up when you have a transformation in effect will double... I'm going to restart that sentence. Anytime you have a transformation in effect, you will double the number of points you get from anything. However, that also includes the points you lose, and the nice thing is you don't normally lose too many points. In fact, I don't think anything makes you lose more than one without a transformation in effect. Be warned, of course, that getting hit will make you lose a point, as will falling off the, Teensy Highway stages, or the Funky Board stages, I think they're supposed to be called. You only lose 1 point at a time, which isn't a huge detriment, but of course, again, it's 2 points if you have a transformation on. Now, we've got Vortex, and I guess its area of effect must be pretty large if it broke two piggy banks, but of course, for this sort of thing, Heavy Metal Fist would be better, even if it does run out quickly. Alright, so I guess since we're on the subject of points, I'll go on a little bit of a tangent. I don't know where, but there was supposed to be a sort of chase enemy by the name of the Zower? That's spelled X-O-W-A-R, I believe. It was supposed to be a chase sequence in ClearLeaf Forest, and apparently it also had a mini-game as well. However, it was too large, so it was ultimately cut from the game in terms of gameplay. However, it is possible to find it, and I don't know off the top of my head if we'll be able to see it in-game, because it is a thing based on points. However, I've never unlocked it, I believe. I have been doing at least a little bit better in terms of doing combos and whatnot in this run than when I was a kid, so maybe we will see it later on. Again, no promises, and it is very late in the game, so even in a test recording, I don't... Well, practice run, rather. I still haven't gotten to the point where I'll actually be able to see it, because that is, well, endgame, actually. So yeah, anyway, yeah, that's the Zower. It's a thing that once was supposed to be here, but isn't here. But if I take a look at my notes, I want to read the description of the Zower, because it's pretty great, actually. The Zower is the kindest of creatures. Oh, that sounds nice. Convinced that Rayman suffers through not having arms and legs, he runs after him to put an end to his torments. So yeah, that's the backstory on that boss. That's Zower, your friendly neighborhood Zower, who, if he thinks you're in pain, will kill you. What a great guy, that one. So, that being said, there's also something... a little bit of an Easter egg that'll be able to point out later as well, so keep good old Zower in your mind. Not that you could forget, anyway. I mean, really, who could forget Zower? What a good boy he is. Alright, so we've pretty much got this area cleared up now. It is one that takes a little while just because there's so many treasures and it's a fairly big area. And you do have to backtrack just a tiny little bit, twice with the heavy metal fist. And of course the other difficulty is just the fact that it runs out so quickly that, yeah, it'll probably run out on you going after that top level door. It's happened to me a lot of times. Had to restart some runs because of it. Oh, and here's an allergic reaction. There he goes. So long, Globa.
Flying objects from a galaxy far, far away. Submit to my power, I repeat.
Glowbox, I think you're mixing your references.
What's up down there? Can't you fly? Like everyone else? Aha! Even spider glutes can't do this.
You know, considering we did actually have a direct reference to Spider-Man earlier on in the game, I guess that can only mean that Glowbox legitimately refers to Spider-Man as Spider-Dude, provided I'm not mishearing that anyway. Ooh, this is a fairly open area. This is also a pretty cool area because it means we also get a new ability here. But first, of course, we do have to explore down here because there's treasure. Alright, no way by there. Not that that's a problem. Oh, and we also have one of those, whatchamacallums there. Tribbles. I always forget that guy's name. So, let's see if we can sneak up and... Ah, damn it. So, Rayman grabbing onto the cliff kind of screwed me out of that one. Ah, well. We'll try again later. For the time being, let's actually see about going to get that power up, because, the one we're about to get is my favorite in the game, actually. Of course, you can probably guess that this teensy right here is... this guy waiting for me over there. He is fairly patient, though. Anyway, you can guess that the teensy right here is going to have a power-up.
I gotta go finish my yoga.
You do that, friend. Okay, so, in the blue can, we get... Lockjaw! So, first off, I'm rather fond of the color scheme. You know, I do like my blues and all. Second off, it is the longest-lasting power-up in the game. Look at that. Look how long it took for one bar to go down. Next off, of course, is the fact that it is the grapple ability of the game, which is very nice. Grapple controls fairly well, I'd say. And lastly, it does change up combat just a little bit. Normally you want to charge, but in this case, as the tutorial text says, as long as you grapple onto enemies, you can then repeatedly press the attack button, and you will electrocute them and... Oop, whoops. Made that Tribbel disappear. Oh well, there's always later. But anyway, yeah. It does make combat a little bit awkward. If that doesn't quite work as well as the grapple, I'd say. Maybe it is just because it does change up combat so much, you know. Rather than strafing, it feels like... I mean, like, you still have to strafe, but it makes strafing feel awkward, I guess, somehow? I don't know, maybe it's just me. Either way, though, you can kill enemies pretty quickly by electrocuting them. And oh, hey, Glowbox, nice of you to float in. Get some gems over here. Glowbox is gonna repeat some quotes. And I missed. Whoops. Guess we'll have to go from the other platform. But first, we'll have to take care of that guy. Taking care of him from a distance. Man, Lockjaw has some range. And again, look how long it's lasting. I mean, I know that Heavy Metal Fist, again, is sort of the poster ability of the game. You saw it in the intro. But, I don't know. Like, having extra power is nice, but it just doesn't last long enough for it to really be interesting. And really, it just augments your basic punching ability. Oh, I know this area. Ooh, hey, I did not see the guy on guard duty. Clever, that one. Clever. But not clever enough, the fool. Because he's dead. And we got the little victory jingle, but we still have danger music. Meaning there are still some guys around here. Ah, hood blasters! And they're playing poker! Can't have that. And Yeah, you wasted too much time opening the door. Okay, so considering there's a heavy door over there, I'm sure you can guess what this guy's gonna give us. Yep, heavy metal fist. We're not gonna be able to do this the first time around, though, because now there are even more enemies. Where did these guys come from? I guess we interrupted the game of poker so hard that these guys sensed it, and now they're out for revenge, which I can understand that. It was probably a pretty good game of poker, and we did kind of murder their friends. Well, not even really, we just destroyed their clothing. Because Black Lums escape, you see it every time, they leave the body, because those hoodlum outfits are just outfits. Oh yeah, did I mention that I never noticed the name Hoodlums last time? Because the name Hoodlums is a pun. Hoodlums, because they're lums. But anyway, yeah, I forget whether or not I mentioned that in Fairy Council. Oh well, I made sure to drill it in this time. Yeah, you... Thank you, Glowbox. Oh, hey, look at that. Got a little plum spike over here. So, right here we have a plum, which is... I don't know, I feel like the game treats it like a platform or a puzzle section because it plays special music and a little victory, special victory jingle for it, but I don't know, it's just as simple as picking this up and throwing it. Basically, you pick it up with the circle button. Yeah, it's the circle button. And you put the plum down with the X button. Did that by accident. And you throw with your usual punch button, the square button. Simple enough. But yeah, it's got its own little jingle for some reason, and I don't know why. Alright, well, we didn't miss any treasure, so we can move on if we get the camera angle correctly. And only 73, huh? Ah, well. Alright, we've entered a fairly sizable section of their base. I can't imagine how they built this up this quickly. We start right off with a hood styler, but that guy was super weak and died almost immediately. They're not much tougher than the hood blasters. They just wear better clothing, I guess. And as per usual, Glowbox still has no patience for Rayman's cosplay. Honestly, Glowbox, aren't you going to indulge us a little bit? So anyway, I completely skipped over the fact that we got a new ability. This is the Shock Rocket. Without staying on the detergent can, it is one of the shortest ability times in the game. I think it's actually only the second shortest, though. We've got a little tutorial for it. It's easy enough, you just press the attack button to start aiming the rocket, and press the attack button again when you want to launch the rocket. You've got full control over the rocket. However, we do have a time limit, as you might have noticed. The time we get is the... basically the ability time down in the bottom right corner. So, use that to determine how much time you have left. We open the gate, and... oh, there's an enemy. However, the shock rocket can also be used for combat. However, it's not really all that good for it, just because, well, A, we have to do this in order to fight, and B, it doesn't really have an excellent life outside of the detergent can, so it's not good for enemies that are close or far away, so I wouldn't suggest using it normally. It is mainly used for puzzles and not combat. That being said, though, holy crap, ugh, god, collecting those gems is just such a good feeling. Especially when you get 2,000 points out of it. Oh, and we get the introduction to a new enemy. And unlike the Hood Styler, this guy actually gets his own little intro. So, these guys are called Hoodbums. Or Hoodbums? Whatever, I've got it written as Hoodbums, but I think that's wrong. Makes more sense as Hoodbums, don't you know? So anyway, yeah, he ran away for the time being, so I don't know if we'll be able to figure out his gimmick just yet. I couldn't possibly figure out what it is. Ah, got another one of these guys. This time I'm fully prepared to sneak up on it. Oop. Dodged a shot as well, because I'm just that at peace going for that guy. Could not sense my aura at all. Oh jeez. I also got shot in the face, so I don't know what that says about me. Alright. Got the Vortex ability, and now we have, as soon as I grab some health,
my kingdom for a bottle.
The Lockjaw, so we can swing right into their base.
Oh,
And, alright, I guess we should open the door for Glowmox as well. Even though this place is probably crawling with enemies and he won't appreciate that, we'll do it anyway. Seriously, though, where are the enemies? I'm ready for them. Though first, I do want to refresh this so that I can double score it up all day, every day. Alright, oh, and we can see from me target, that guy was there. As is this guy. It's not a problem, and oh darn, that hood boom's jumped in. Alright, so we can't reach him right now, but if we get rid of the Slapdash, we can use the Shock Rocket for combat and destroy this man with the very thing that he holds dear, explosives. He died as he lived, exploding. Oh, what a poor, unfortunate soul. And Glowmox is just gonna be very impatient and go right for the plum juice. Ah, he's doing the worm. Oh, well, that's what happens when you drink fermented plum juice. Oh yeah, I didn't mention that back there, but, yeah, you can't say boobs, but you can say fermented, basically implying that Andre is getting Glowmox drunk, if this plum juice really is fermented, which, considering it's being collected by the hoodlums who I assume know Andre's taste, it probably is. Would explain the weird Glowmox behavior, but yeah. To be fair, I don't think most kids know what the word fermented means in that context, so they probably wouldn't immediately think, oh, yeah, Glowmox is getting super blitzed right now. Alright, well, Glowmox, you can wait there for the time being. I've gotta grab these gems. It's important to collect treasure. Murphy told me so. I think that's the one word of wisdom I've ever taken from him. I mean, it's more than one word, treasure is good, but still, it's the one bit of advice. Alright, well, we'll go get Lockjaw again and see if we can get a few more points out. I said, we'll get Lockjaw again and see if we can get a few more points off of this. I mean, we might as well try, right? There aren't too many gems around here. Oh, that would have been useful, but I forgot he was there, apparently. Oh well, so you can get 500 points right there if you nab Lockjaw and just patiently walk over to that dude whose name I've yet again forgotten. That's a Trebell, right, yeah. Okay, so I don't believe this is the end of this particular stage just yet. Oh yeah, we've got a whole lot of boxes. Oh, hello, I'm just gonna get rid of you. And get rid of... Oh, no, no, kick fight! We kick-fought a guy earlier, but yeah, Rayman will actually kick if you get into close combat fights. It's not something you see very often, because it's better to, you know, stay out of range of those guys, especially since they will also melee you, and also, I'm pretty sure I could get you from here. Yep, there he goes. But yeah, they can melee you as well. They will smack you with their musket, or whatever they happen to have. They can also defend from weaker shots, in case I haven't mentioned it, but I'm pretty sure that's been visible at some point. Probably. Alright, so anyway, whole lot of treasure and it's all kind of separated, but I will grab it anyway. There's probably a faster way to do this that, you know, is better for combos, but I'm not really the best at that. Actually, to be fair, you should also probably wait to grab these gems at least. Just because there is a transformation around here that will, of course, double your points, and that is always appreciated. Gotta get them minigames. Alright, yeah, as I said, unfortunately, it does take a few moments. Ooh, grab the red gem first. It does take a few moments to grab these since they're fairly far apart. Ah, man, I screwed up twice. Past me, what were you even doing? Oh yeah, you didn't want to restart the stage because you'd already done that several times. Okay, actually, yeah, I can emphasize that. Alright. So, we've got a dude in a cage around here, but unfortunately, he's behind a wooden door as well. And guarded, but we don't care about that. That's just a hoodlum. We can punch those guys till they die, but doors? Nah, they're tricky. Alright, there's a guy patrolling down there. Where is he? Ah, there he is. Okay, so we're going to stealth kill him. I did it in a previous run. I'm going to do it. Oh, I probably shouldn't have jump shot. But then again, the platform would probably stop my shot. And oh, man, he was ready for me. Jeez. Apparently, they actually saw me coming. And I can't understand how that happened. I saw no reason for that. All right, so we open this cage right here. The only one you can miss is the one outside, and I actually did miss that on my, practice file. I didn't realize that you had to break it open with a shock rocket. I thought you had to somehow find a way to use the heavy metal fist on it, but no, that's not what you're supposed to do. This, however, is necessary, and I don't know why it shows you the transformation again. That's kind of annoying. I don't want to see that animation more than just for the introduction phase. And from him, you get another one. We gotta chain these heavy metal fists together in order to get to the end of the stage. And I could be doing a better job at that. I'm going very slowly, actually. Come on, past me. You can do a little better than this. Now I'm getting annoyed. And hey, we're already halfway to a new health extension. But sadly, there's only one more Teensy and ClearLeaf Forest. Yeah, that's right. We're actually almost done with this entire chapter. In fact, we're done with this stage. And with that done, we're going to be moving on to the boss stage. So, Fairy Council didn't have its own boss. I guess you could count Andre as the boss?
You cracked me up!
Not really, actually. So, we'll take out this sleeping guy right here, and there's a missing Teensy, but how are you going to miss it? It's right there. You'd have to be ignoring it on purpose, and if you do that, you're just a jerk. Alright, so, I'd just like to say, from practice file experience, the bosses in this game are not that good. And this guy, starting off, is pretty bad, actually. This is Master Cag. More on him in just a moment, but, yeah, this guy's very annoying. He does have a good song, but his gimmick's kinda bad. He will slowly follow you around and attempt to stomp you. You have to press the three buttons. Make sure he's far away from the center once you press the third button, because by pressing this, you create a shock rocket. However, he will book it on over to the shock rocket and crush it if not fast enough. The other thing that's annoying here is actually hitting him. You sort of have to predict where he's going to go and get ahead of him. Otherwise, the shock rocket isn't fast enough to trail behind him and hit him successfully 80% of the time, not 100%. Anyway, Master Cag is actually interesting because his name is derived from the old name of the Hoodlums before they were actually the Hoodlums. Before they were called the Cagoulards, that's K-A-G-O-U-L-A-R-D-S. I don't know if there's a pun there, but I definitely prefer the name Hoodlums. It works so much better from a pun standpoint and a this-is-what-they-are standpoint. But anyway, another fun fact about Master Cag is he is a little baby hoodlum. It's hard to notice because, you know, they're all lums, but yeah, apparently he's a baby. And Rayman will just immediately use the legs to fight, and this segment, unfortunately, isn't that good. It's not difficult, but it's not that good. A whole lot of hood stylers are going to rush the arena, and, oh yeah, by the way, suddenly there's an announcer. But the legs don't really feel like they move that well. They're very sluggish, it's hard to turn them, which, you know, makes sense, but, that doesn't mean it's fun to play. If you press the attack button, you can do that stomp. You can crush the hoodlums normally, but it's just easier to sort of stomp on them because they'll home in and what are you talking about? But anyway, yeah, when you do the stomp, it will home in on them slightly. Anyway, though, this goes on for far too long, and again, this thing doesn't really control the best. Usually when, you know, you have something that's super powerful, you don't want to make it too annoying to control. Slower is understandable, but I think this is too far for, you know, the whole you have a powerful thing segment. At the very least, I don't think you can die? Anyway, since we're done with that, we have a whole lot more time left to fill. Let's move on to the announcer. I don't really like this at all as a joke. In part because there's no setup to it. I mean, there doesn't need to be a lot of setup, but, like, he wasn't there for the first half of the fight. He just appears here because I guess the designers realized that this on its own would be too boring, so they tried to spice it up. It doesn't work. I guess to set it up better, they, I don't know, could have had, like, an announcer table up at the top area. Rayman's whole thing is just being weird aesthetically, so it's not like it'd be out of place, but they could also have him, like, actually talking during the first half of the battle, and, you know, maybe being very pessimistic towards Rayman and then optimistic here out of nowhere. I think that'd work. The other problem is, I don't think this guy really puts any effort in. Like, the voice actor's not that good. Which sucks, because the voice cast is pretty good throughout the game. I love Glowbox and Andre, and Rayman's pretty good as well, but this guy, his delivery just isn't good. I mean, he did the... Oh shoot, it's Evil Dead, I want to say, where the bubblegum line comes from. But they completely screwed up that reference. Duke Nukem did it better. And even then, it's pretty weak in the first place. But yeah, in general, his delivery sucks. I don't know, if you want a better, like, announcer joke, Saints Row 4 is the first one that comes to mind. The voice actors for that are excellent, and they actually have good, funny dialogue to work with. I love those two guys. They're just talking about the match and or whatever minigame you're doing, and then they'll just suddenly lapse into being very depressed that their homeworlds were destroyed and that they were enslaved by Zinyak. They do that excellently. There is actually good delivery in that game. So anyway, this is a stage, I guess. Really, the only thing here are the three hoodlums that are guarding the place, and yet somehow that is enough to make my emulator run like garbage. I guess my computer just really doesn't like this section. Either way, though, you can take out three hood blasters, right? You've been doing that up until this point. You should be able to do it now. See, we're done. Oh, and by the way, you aren't even ranked on this stage. Yeah, there are gems to collect and enemies to kill, but you don't get a percentage for it. You just go on to the next stage after we're done here. That being said, though, that's not going to stop me from collecting these, because I need all the points I can get. Gotta unlock those minigames. Right, so, since the rest of this area is mirrors, let's leap into this place.
Well, let's see what we have here, if you don't mind. Ah. Ah, I see you swallowed a black lump. We will need to resort to drastic measures. Problem is worse than I thought. You see, the black clumps has taken refuge in a fistula by going through a kidney near a spare rib. You will need to consult a stomach specialist. I know a very good doctor who lives in the land of the living dead. I leave you now. I must go clean my instruments.
Alright, well, that was our first doctor visit. Of course, it's not as simple as going to one doctor when you've got a medical emergency. Oh no, they gotta shuffle you to another one. But I guess it's either that or 3 hours on hold. Or, I guess, traveling through the world where most of the living beings you find will try to kill you? There really aren't a whole lot of good possibilities. Anyway, I haven't been talking about the stage itself, have I? So this is our second funky boarding section, and I actually hate that first little bit I was talking over, because that made me kind of motion sick. I don't know about you, but yeah. This stage also, I believe, introduces us to the falling platforms. They blend in with the rest of the platforms, but I believe they're always that same very short size. Maybe they're kind of orangish. They don't appear out of nowhere or move. Oh yeah, I actually really hate the moving platforms. Those suck. More than the falling platforms, because at least you can get to those, but these, yeah, those pretty frequently screw me up, actually. I don't care for them. That being said, other than that, yeah, not too much to talk about. It's another funky boarding section. It's fun. Didn't take too long for me to get this down in one perfect attempt. But at the same time, yeah, it's a whole lot of trial and error, but it is a stage that normally allows trial and error, and the only punishment for falling is -1 point, so that's not horrible. You can't die here, so yeah, it's pretty good, and sometimes Glowbox will yell a thing at you, and I appreciate that. Sadly, we won't see him or the helicopter that's carrying him, because, well, that only happens if you're falling. And I ain't fallen. I'm too cool for that. That being said, though, you can tell that I was a little bit nervous about jumping around after many failed attempts. And, things are looking a little bit weird up there on the Teensy Highway. That doesn't look right. Oh, dear. Well, I don't know where we're going, but if the Teensy Highway's broken like that, next time on Rayman 3, I don't think we're going to the Land of the Livid Dead.